Good morning, everyone. I'd just like to ask you to take your seats. We're going to be starting in the next 5 minutes. Please be seated. Find a seat if you can. Next 5 minutes.
Just reminding you that when we close the casket here, it will not be opened again. Once we close in the next couple of minutes, it will not be opened again. Thank you. Just informing the members, the bereaved members, that we are about to close the casket. Members of the immediately bereaved family, we are about to close the casket now, and we'll be starting our procession. Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Sir, you may. Okay, Brother Davis, we're going to be closing them, sir. Yes. Thank you, yes. Thank you, sir, Madam. Please join the procession down there, right behind Dr. Peart. They're waiting on you. I didn't know you were here. Okay. Orlean was trying to help us to raise enough money to build a 1,500-seater tabernacle, but she said she cannot wait anymore. COVID came and robbed us 4 years of such a time. Since she had to leave before. And now we are going to be asking you to stand as we begin as soon as the casket is closed. Take your time, we're not rushing you, sir. That's it, huh? Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or even thou hast formed the earth and the world. Even from everlasting to everlasting. Thou art God. Thou turnest man to destruction and sayest, return, ye children of men. For 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday when it is past. And as a watch in the night. The days of our years are 70 years. And if by reason of strength, they may be 80. Yet is their strength, labor, and sorrow. For it is soon cut off, and we fly away. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts into wisdom. A person who is born of a woman is of a few days. And those few days are full of trouble. Such one cometh forth like a flower, then is cut down. Here she fleeth away also as a shadow, and continueth not. If a human dies, shall he live again? All the days of my appointed time will I wait till my change come. Then thou shalt call me, and I will answer you. Then you will have a desire to the work of your hands. Behold, I show you all a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So then, when this corruption shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? And grave, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, everyone. God is our refuge and our strength, an ever-present help in time of distress. This morning we are comforted, knowing very well that the God of Jacob is with us, even at this time of our loss. We want to say good morning to our audience on the World Wide Web as we stream live to you from Davie Community Worship Center, located in Davie, Florida. Welcome to this, the celebration service of homegoing for our dear departed sister, Orlean Campbell Davis. We will commence our service by singing the well-known song, Beulah Land, a song that talks about the Christian life today as one that borders heaven and from where one can almost see heaven. It speaks of a place of victory and fellowship with God. So we are going to blend our hearts and voices, and lustily, we are going to be singing Beulah Land. So I'm going to ask you to change your place, stand with us. as we sing heartily, Beulah Land. Hallelujah. I am convinced this morning that you'll all join me in saying that our hopes are set on that beautiful celestial suburb, Beulah Land, a place where there will be no misunderstanding, a place where there will be no misgiving, and that's the place we're singing about this morning, Beulah Land. Coming to us this morning to offer prayer is our minister, Minister Sharon Thomas. She will be asking the Lord's blessing on today's service. And she's from the Faith Center Church.
Praise the Lord. The Lord bless you. The Lord bless you. Giving honor to the Spirit of God, to our Bishop of the House, and all the elders in your respectful places, and each and every one here today. On behalf of Bishop and Pastor Carolyn, the entire Faith Center family, we send our condolences not only to the family, the husband, mom and dad, the brother, sisters, everyone connected, but to the community that have come out today. God bless you. I love connection. So if even you can wrap your arm around the next person or touch the next person, put your hand on their shoulder as a form of contact, the community of the church. Father, we lift our eyes to thee this morning. No other help we know. If you should withdraw yourself from us, where shall we go? God Almighty, the lover of our soul, the Alpha and the Omega, beginning and the end, the first and the last, the glorious one, our Jehovah, our Redeemer, our Savior and friend. We look to you this morning, O God, because we have none other. We look to you this morning, Almighty God, on behalf of the family, on behalf of those that are grieving, the community, God, those that have come out, those online, Almighty God. And we ask you to bring comfort. We ask you to meet each and every one at the point of their need this morning. Lord God, you are a comfort to the comfortless. And your word declares that blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. This morning, God, there is weeping in the heart. But we are not weeping at those that don't have any hope, because we know that our dear sister is absent from the body. Hallelujah. But Lord, she is present with you. What a consolation, oh God. Will we miss her? Yes, we will. Will we miss the place where she sat? Yes, we will. Will we miss her voice? Yes, we will. Will we miss the times of embrace and sweet communion? Yes, we will. But God, we know, hallelujah, this is not the end. Thank you for that Beulah land that your daughter has made it into. God, on those times when the tears want to come, you said you will never leave us nor forsake us. On the times, oh God, that we're asking questions, oh God, you said you will never leave us nor forsake us. And on the times, oh God, that we see her smile, we see her praise dance, we see her singing, God, the memory will still be alive. The word says, blessed are they that die in the Lord, because their works will continue. Let her works continue through the lives of each and every one of here, oh God. May you bless, may you keep, may you sanctify us. God, let your comfort fill this place. And let her life be a representation, oh God, of the love that you gave, the breath that you blew into her. The Lord gives. And the Lord said, come home, my daughter. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Surround each and every one with your comfort and with your love. These and all thy many blessings we ask. In no other name but the name that's above every name, The name at which every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. To the honor and glory of your name, O God, in Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Thank you so much, Minister. Coming to us at this time is Miss Jacqueline Davis, sister-in-law, and she will be reading the first lesson and will be followed by Miss Sandy Brooks. The first lesson this morning will be taken from 1 Thessalonians 4, and we'll be reading from verse 13 through 18. If you're not incapacitated by reason of health, I'm going to ask you to stand so that for the reading of the scriptures, please.
Good morning, everyone. The lesson today is taken from 1 Thessalonians 4, reading from verse 13 to 18. This is for believers who have died. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that he sorrow not, even as other which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so then also which sleep in Jesus will God bring him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we are all alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord, shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive or remain shall be caught up together, which then in the clouds, to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we even be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Ms. Sandy Brooks.
Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Thank you so much, and you may now be seated. I'd like to say that there is a common denominator that identifies us this morning, and not only identifying us, but unifying us in our grief for our dear departed sister, dear departed friend, dear departed daughter, dear departed family member and co-worker. This morning I pause to recognize the grieving family, the Campbell family, the Davis family, and the Murdoch family in particular. By extension, I'd also like to recognize all the clergy that are present here today. And what better way to start by recognizing our dear bishop, the bishop of the house, Dr. Fedlin Beeson and his wife Esmond, seated on the podium to my right. Bishop Dr. George Peart, seated to my right. Dr. and Pastor Oral Beeson Esquire, who is our local pastor and youth pastor, of course, want to recognize you. We'd like to recognize quite a number of traveling bishops that I'm told that are here. Bishops Oliver Sobrien, Bishop John Stammy, Bishop Jennifer Porter Cox from Shepherd's House Church of God, Fort Washington in Maryland, Bishop Patrick Benjamin, Bishop Glenford Hutchinson, Bishop Dennis Campbell, Bishop Patricia Emmanuel, and of course, Bishop Terence Brown, among many others who I'm yet to be told or have not been told. We also want to acknowledge that special group from the organization called Community Care Plan. And that group of people and organization is the former employer of our dear departed sister, Orlene Campbell Davis. I want to say to you, family, that the David Community Worship Center grieve with you, and we want to identify with you even more to say to you that your loss is our loss. But this morning, we do not grieve as those who have no hope. We are here to celebrate the good and the golden memories, and to remind ourselves that the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're going to go straight into our tributes. And just before going into the tributes, I just want to make some disclosures that we're going to be asking all those who will be giving tributes, try and be very collegial. I say collegial because we want to make sure that you allow others to speak. And we're going to be having counter to see if you're going beyond. And we ask you, please, please adopt to that if you can and adhere to. And coming to us for the first tribute is Bishop Oliver Sobrien from Maryland. I'd like for you to make him feel welcome.
How many minutes?
If you can do two or three.
Yeah. I got 3 minutes and I got my counter. Greetings to you all. Blessings to you. We honor God, who is the reason why we are all here today. Honor the angel of this house and his wife and all the other ministers that are here today who was already recognized. I greet you all in Jesus' name. I stand here today to represent the Ebenezer Church of God in Landover Hills, Maryland. Some of our members are here. Some are watching via social media. But we are here because, not because Earlene died, but we're here because she lived. And what a life she lived. What an impression she made on our lives. Came to us in 1992, spent 8 beautiful years before she left for Florida and her better family. At that time, we felt as if we were robbed of a precious treasure. Feel like we've lost some things of value, because the entire family are like the way Earlene is and was. But then I get to thinking that if you know where something is, then you really didn't lose it. And that is where we are right now. Because we know what we know, and we know where Arlene is, then we have not truly lost her. I think, and I always believe, and I know that she is a special treasure. She reminds me of Genesis, the last chapter, the last verse, where it says, Joseph, being 110 years old, died and was buried, placed in a coffin and buried in Egypt. In a coffin. That word coffin is just used once in the King James Bible. But it's where we have placed Arlene today. A coffin, a coffer, a coffer, a treasure chest, a place where you put all your treasure. That's where she is today, and that's where she's going. Do you know God fixed her up as a beautiful treasure here on earth? And while he's fixing her up on earth, he's fixing up her home in heaven, which is also a treasure. Streets of gold, walls of jasper, gates of pearl. So he's taking his treasure, placing her in his treasure chest to take her to his treasure city. I hope you all get there one day. God bless you.
Thank you so much, Bishop. Yes, we're going to be calling on our pastor, Dr. Oral Beeson, and he'll be coming at this time. Let him feel welcome.
Parson, you know, see me? Parson, you know, see me? With all protocol observed, that is how my sister greeted me. Parson, you know, for my non-Jamaicans, my pastor, don't you see me? That is how my sister greeted me. Good morning to all. We all grieve and are heartbroken today. But Psalm 147, 3 says, he heals the brokenhearted. He heals the brokenhearted. So we place it all today in the Master's hands. All our grief, all our sorrow, all our pain, our sadness. The lack of understanding. Put it in his hands. You see, Orlean positively affected everybody in this church. You know how you have a building and it's, for my engineers, they'll tell you they have load-bearing walls, right? You go to your house, some walls you can knock down and you'll be fine. Some walls you can't knock down because the building is on top of the wall. This church, that's one of the walls. As was said yesterday and this morning, thank you. She was a member, she was the director of our praise and worship team. For those of you who have never been here, if you're logged in on our streaming platforms, she was the director of our praise and worship. She was a member and the assistant director of our choir, our senior choir. She's the director of the youth choir. She was the secretary for the Sunday school. She was the co-director of the Creative Arts Ministry. She was the director of the DCWC Dance Ministry. She was the VP of the Young Ladies Ministry. She was a member of the Youth Board. She was a member of the Medical Care Ministry. She was a Banquet Committee member. She was a DCWC Drama Ministry member. She was a Pastor's Care Committee member. And she was a member of the Hospitality Committee. When I tell you, this child was just about everything in this church. And anything needed to be done. Oh, dear man, we only say, no worry, man. We got these, one of the youngsters last night testified that she would come pick them up for dance class and didn't charge them gas money. That was the takeaway, right? She did everything in here, man. I'm telling you, she touched just about every single ministry, every single auxiliary. You know, last, for those who were here yesterday, you saw that most of the our young people and many of us were had different t-shirts on with slogans on. Those were the t-shirts from our years past youth convention. Every year we would have a youth convention. The reason why we have a youth, had we started youth convention was because of Orlean. Orlean said, hey, we did that in Maryland and we're going to do it here. And we're like, what are you talking about? No, and she insisted. So when you come to youth convention, that's Orlean's brainchild. All right? Yeah, today, again, as I said, we're mourning. We're all in different stages of grief over the loss of our daughter, our sister, our niece, our cousin, our wife, our friend, our counselor, our co-worker, our colleague, our classmates. This people from high school yesterday came and gave tribute. And so many more hats that she wore. But in each instance, she embodied grace. She embodied grace, which was evocative of her middle name. You know, one day she said to me, Pastor, what's my middle name? I said, I don't remember. She said, it's Grace, Pastor, Grace. And from that day, I didn't forget. Matter of fact, I put it as a contact in my phone, was OGC, Orlean Grace Campbell. And Perry, when she got married, I added OGCD, right? Just so I, but I'm telling you. And she would always ask, you good? Anybody, you good? And she really didn't want just the passing, yeah, I'm all right. She wanted to know if you are good, if you're okay. So today, on behalf of the bishop and his wife, which are my parents, my wife Dee and my family, the pastor's council and their spouses, the elders and their families, each department, ministry, auxiliary head of this church, all members, all friends and families of DCWC, to Orlean's family, from her church family and her peoples, we want to let you know that we're always, you always have our support and our love. And today, as Brother Fred said, your grief is our grief. I told Daddy Altie and Sister Cherry yesterday, Auntie Cherry yesterday, that they may have birthed her, but she was ours too, right? All right, so with that, Auntie Cherry, Brother Alty, Dwight, Perry, and the entire family. And listen, the Murdoch clan, she always talked about the Murdoch family. You know, so that's her people's mind. You would not, your mama got a Murdoch meeting on this, the whole nine yards. So she loved you guys. She spoke fondly about you. We offer you a comforting ear, a hug, a shoulder, anytime you want. Anytime you want. Danielle, my girl, I know it's going to be hard, but anything you want. And we don't, these are not just words. Call us, call upon us anytime. OGC, my friend, miss see you. And today we all see you, my sister. God bless you.
Thank you, Pastor Oral. Speaking of friendship and acquaintance, coming back from so far, I remember them, Pastor Oral and Sister Orlean, as little children when they all worshiped at the New Testament Church of God in Jamaica, where I was a member. I remember them very well. And what has come home to me here just now is I'm hearing the lyrics of the song that Orlean's mom sung last night. Orlean has traded her sorrow. Hallelujah. Traded her sorrow for a golden crown. Hallelujah. That does resonate very well. And so coming to us, we will continue our tributes. And we'll be calling on Miss Jessica Lerner. As the name Lerner implies, we're going to learn more about Sister Orlean and they both work at the same place. So Miss Jessica Lerner, please come forward and let her feel welcome, please.
Good morning, and thank you for the opportunity to share this tribute. I got the privilege to meet Orlean in January of 2017 when she joined our community care family. And is thank you. As Minister Thomas said, community is so important, and that's why we have the name we have. And what you may not know is we're known as the health plan with a heart, and that heart, in part, in a large part, had to do with Orlean. And she brought everything that you spoke of and everything that she had learned to our family and community. She taught us to share our heart with others, with everyone that we serve and everyone that we help. She taught us that just always going beyond to help another family who is dealing with difficult conditions. We actually have something called the Story from the Heart that we share with our organization all the time that we can, and all those stories are really because Orlean showed us how important it was to go above and beyond to help others through difficulty. This year, we actually established the highest recognition in our organization, which is called the Heart of Excellence Award. And we were so grateful and thankful to share that with Orlean and her family before she left us. And that work is going to continue through her in our organization, because that recognition will continue every single year in her honor and in her memory. And it will always be known as the Orly Award. And this incredible CCP family had the honor to have her with us. And I thank you, her family, for sharing her with us for all that time. And her work will continue through all of us. And we miss her already, and we're grateful. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Truly, we have learned much of our dear sister Orlean's character and what great legacy she has left with us. Coming to us at this time, we are going to be calling on Miss Shani Gallimore. And she will be offering a tribute in solo, a song. Can you make her feel welcome, please?
Hello, my name is Shahani. You can call me Shay. Orlean was my auntie, and she was a beautiful person, and I know we've heard a lot of songs already, but if you'll allow me to tribute this song to her, I'd be very grateful. It's called Supermarket Flowers.
I took the supermarket flowers from the windowsill, poured the day-old tea from up the photo album that you had made. Memories of a life that's been loved. Took the get well soon cards and stuffed animals. Threw the old ginger beer down the sink. Mom always told me, don't you cry when you're down. But Mom, there's a tear every time that I blink. Oh, I'm in pieces, it's tearing me up. But I know a heart that's broke is a heart that's been loved. So I'll sing hallelujah. You were an angel in the shape of my aunt. When I fell down, you'd be there holding me up. Spread your wings as you go. And when God takes you back, he'll say, hallelujah, you're home. Fluffed the pillows, made the bed, stacked the chairs up. Loaded your nightgowns neatly in a case. Mom said she'd drive, then put her hand on my cheek and wiped a tear from the side of my face. I hope that I see the world as you did, 'cause I know a heart with love is a heart that's been lived. So I'll sing hallelujah. You were an angel in the shape of my aunt. When I fell down, you'd be there holding me up. Spread your wings as you go. And when God takes you back, he'll say hallelujah, you're home. To see the person I have become, spread your wings, and I know that when God took you back, he said, hallelujah, you're home.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for that vocal. Coming to us is Bishop John Stammey. Let him feel welcome. And, yes. And Bishop John Stammey is the current pastor of Orleans Parents Church in Winter Haven,
yes.
Church of God.
Good morning. Let me start by saying, family, thank you for the honor and the privilege of just being able to bring a greeting to you and bring to you what the Lord has laid on my heart. I asked Brother and Sister Campbell, what in the world am I going to say? And now that I know I've got 2 minutes, what in the world am I going to say and how fast can I get it out? All joking aside, I asked the Lord, and the Lord gave me a scripture, because I bring to you this morning on behalf of the Winter Haven Church of God greetings. We have prayed with you for quite some time. We have mourned with you, and we are mourning with you even today. We continue to pray for you and with you. But because we know Jesus Christ, We do something different than the rest of the world today. Today we celebrate. We may be two different churches, but a saint of God has found her reward, and we rejoice for her. The Bible says, in fact, Paul says, for me to live is Christ. For me to die is gain. We feel loss. We've got to remember her death because she knew Jesus. She gained. She gained something wonderful. And the scripture that God laid upon my heart points us to those wonderful things that God has prepared for those that love him. Listen to the scriptures in Revelations. It says, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. I know one thing's for sure. To be absent from the body means to be present with the Lord. And where she is, there is no more pain. There is no more sorrow. There is no more cancer. And so we rejoice for her today. I'm looking forward to the day when all this is all over. You heard the scriptures already read that the dead in Christ shall go first, and then we which are alive and remain shall meet them and forever be with the Lord. I'm looking forward to that day. These moments seem so long. The Bible says life is like a vapor. Here one minute, gone the next. Make sure you're ready. Make sure you're ready.
Thank you so much, Bishop. I echo that in saying that earth's loss is heaven's gain. Hallelujah. Brother Dwight, I don't know if you are ready for us. I pray God's strength for you as you come to us. Dwight, brother of our dear departed sister, let him feel welcome, please.
Honestly, I'm more worried about getting in trouble up here with some of the things I may have to say. But thank you guys for being here. Wow. Okay. All right. I'm just going to ramble a little bit. Want to bring a little bit of realness to my sister, you know what I mean? Not that everything you guys have said, it's all good. She was great. We all know she was a beautiful person. I got this thing down here that I'm reading. So she was beautiful, man. She was the person that I could count on, you know, no matter what. You know, I could always hit her up and, you know, she would give me her true, honest opinion. Going on with my life. So, you know, we fought, we laughed, we went through it all. We used to beef at times, hardcore, you know, but that's just what you go through as siblings. She bailed me out of a lot of situations. I would run like all my relationships through her, anybody I was dating. In fact, I looked through our WhatsApp folder the other day and I was like, oh my God. You know what I mean? All these different pictures. I was like, maybe I have a problem, you know? But I was just like looking through. I was like, just looking at all these responses, you know?
Hold on.
You know, it was, but she kept it real. I mean, she always kept her eye on me. I couldn't run anything by her. In fact, the weekend, you know, I was in LA. And I was talking to her on the phone. I could just hear it in her voice that, you know, she wasn't doing well. And I got on the plane. I came the next day. And that's the weekend that I took her to the hospital. And, you know, everything went, quote, unquote, downhill from there. But when we were in the emergency room, they were trying to, you know, they were trying to get the blood, you know. They were doing all this stuff. and sorry, forgive me. You know, there was a cute nurse that came through. She was just there, you know, and they were doing all this stuff, you know. She walked out, and Arlene was like, "You like that one there?" I was like, "How did you?" I promise you, I wasn't staring past her. I wasn't, you know. But I was like, "How did she?" I was like, "She was all right, you know." But basically, she knew me, you know. Like she just could read me like a book. Let me see. You know, and there's a part of Arlene that was also lonely, you know, because she was an avid people pleaser, you know, and, you know, because she was always looking out for everybody else. And sometimes, like, with people like Arlene, you know, their cups get empty, and you would never even know it. So even moving on from this, you know, we got to think about people, you know, like her, you know, a good spirit, they're always happy, just make sure you give it right back to them. You know, I'm not saying that a lot of people didn't, but you know what I mean? Just don't, "Oh, that person is so great." No one could just be like that 100% of the time. You know, they go through things, and she went through a lot, you know? She was stubborn. She was really stubborn, you know? And she watched way too much 90 Day Fiancé. Too much. Get on my nerves, you know? Too many cat videos. I actually thought she was trying to low-key shade me because she knows that I'm always in some long-distance relationship. So every time I came over, it was 90, I was like, "Okay, I see what you're trying to say." I think she spent way too much time at church sometimes, even though it's a good thing. Too much, you know? Just being real. Not saying it's not, you know what I mean, but just bring some balance to the situation. She was also, again, she was stubborn and she was avoidant, you know? So she would avoid a lot of different things, you know? And I would always get on to her, "Arlene, you gotta face it, you gotta face it, you gotta face it." But that's just her, that's a part of her, you know? And the other thing I wanna say is Perry. It's kind of weird for me to say give Perry a round of applause. It's kind of weird, but I just want to like salute you, you know? Thank you so much. Thank you so much for what you did, man. You know, I would tell you all the time, I would look at you and I was like, "Man, thank God, you know, that she has you." And I don't know how better to extend my gratitude, man, but you're real, like we would say, you're a real G. You're a real man. You know what I mean? We all stood here, watched you give your vows. I'm sorry, I don't mean to be so long. But we watched you, you know, exchange these vows, and you held to it. You know what I mean? You did your thing. And that man right there, you know what I mean, is to be recognized. I'm going to wrap this up. Hold on. let me see. And also, the last thing I want to say is that, like, also, when you know, some people could get locked in, you know, to being, everyone thinks I'm so happy all the time. I'm not saying that she wasn't, and that she wasn't who she is. But sometimes you can get locked into that role, you know what I mean? And it gives you could be imprisoned by it. So even though you see people are happy, and they're giving, and they're all of that stuff, you know what I mean? Make sure you also give them the freedom to have flaws. You know, the freedom to express themselves, the freedom to not have a good day, right? Because not because you think, "Oh, they're always happy. So they get locked into that. And even in Arlene, some of Arlene's last days, I knew her because I talked to her all the time, blah, blah, blah. I could get a sense of what's really going on. You know, even she would try to protect everybody in her last days. You would never know that she was really on her way out. And that's because of that sometimes, you know what I mean? Because they can't see me, you know, have a bad day. So, you know, moving forward through life and after this, as beautiful, and I'm not saying my sister wasn't beautiful, but she is everything that you guys say that she is. But make sure you give people like her the freedom to, like, be themselves. And the last thing, the very last thing, I know, sorry. You know, it's one of those things, like we come to church and we do all this stuff, but also let's put emphasis on our health, you know? Let's take care of ourselves, you know? The science is there, you know what I mean? Not saying that you could prevent everything, but let's exercise. Let's eat right. Let's do all the things to help us, you know, to put us in a better situation, because that's what God wants us to do, right? It's a temple. So we have a responsibility also. Let's do what we can, right? Right? That's it. Let's take care of our emotional health, our mental health. Let's do that too. It's not just all God, God, God. He gives us the knowledge and the wisdom to do all those things. There are books out there besides the Bible and things like that, that there are subjects, you know? There's a science, and we need to make sure we take care of all of those things encompassing. All right? Thank you. Appreciate it.
Coming from the heart of a brother. A brother with brotherly love. And Brother Perry, your ratings have gone up. So says your brother, right? Okay, coming to us at this time is someone who is no stranger to us, very well known in the Church of God circles, Minister Reverend Jennifer Porter Cox from Maryland. Let her feet welcome.
Praise the Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. This is the day the Lord hath made. We will continue to rejoice, and we're going to be glad in it. May I borrow your counter, sir? I'm asking Bishop Sobran to lend me his counter, so that I'm not standing here too long. Thank you, Dwight. Thank you so much. That was very well said and very well needed. Thank you so much. Thank you. I want to thank God, acknowledge the big shepherd of this house, Bishop Dr. Fedlin Beeson and his wife, Lady Esmond Beeson. I want to thank God for the pastor of this house, all the other ministers and bishops and pastors, everyone in your rightful place. I honor you today. For the bereaved family, Brother and Sister Campbell, Brother Perry, I just had a chance to meet you and all the family. No words we can say can make this okay, but we stand with you and we honor God and we celebrate with you during this time. And I'm going to talk. Someone sent me a quote recently, a portion of a quote from Pope Francis. And the reading says, "Rivers do not drink their own water. Trees do not eat their own fruit. The sun does not shine on itself, and flowers do not spread their fragrance for themselves." He said, living for others is a rule of nature. We are born to help each other. Orlean learned this from a very young age. I think it was back in 1995, 96, when I was at Ebenezer. And I was over the young lady's ministries. I met Orlean, the entire family at that time. And she was one of the young ladies under my charge. There were some in that group who were just naturally troublesome. They didn't have to try to give trouble. They're off to my right. I won't look over there, but they're looking all dignified today, but they're just naturally troublesome, but not Orlean. And so whenever in the group, if something went wrong, The running statement was, "Sister J is not Orlean. She's a good one. We know she's a good one." And I listened last night to all the tributes. Sister Delva, I don't know if she's here today. She made a statement. Question she asked rhetorically yesterday was, "Where's the lie?" You know, I don't even realize you realize how hard that statement hit, because everybody, one after the other, kept saying the same thing about Orlean's character. And we didn't have to try. It's not a lie. We are not dressing anything up. She was always one of the good ones. And like Dwight, let me give a little pastoral trouble. When things like these happen, we tiptoe around certain things we want to say. And one of her co-workers yesterday evening made me smile. She went close. And she said, I was almost a little bit vexed with Jesus. Anybody remember that? But she said it in that, please don't zap me, God, kind of a voice. Because we are cultured to believe that if we express our pain, then it speaks to a lack of faith. But I believe every one of us with Orlean got to that place of, how come? We didn't want it to be anybody else but Orlean. We get to that place of, please God, don't zap me. But and it caused me to think about Psalm 73, where Asaph was having a rough day, a day. I can hear Bishop Fedlin Beeson talking about Asaph. Yep. Asaph literally said to God, I don't get it. And in verse number 1, he said, he gave God, what is this? He said, listen, you are a good God, but... He said, let me put that out there. I'm not backsliding. You're a good God. He said, but I'm seeing wicked people. I'm seeing all this madness, people who don't even talk to you. And their lives look so easy. How come? He said, I feel like I repented in vain. But then he just pitched a fit. And then in verse 17, he said, until I came into the sanctuary of the Lord. That is why we can rejoice. We have a God and a faith who allows us our humanity. And it shredded me, Orlean. How come? But you know what? The scriptures, Bishop, I heard you when you spoke, always lands us safely. Isaiah 57, I randomly bumped, not randomly, the Lord. Listen to Isaiah 57. We asking how come? We celebrate today because God has done nothing wrong. God has done nothing wrong. Listen to Isaiah 57. Good people pass away. The godly often die before their time. But here's the second half of the verse. But no one seemed to care or wonder why. We're like, why Orlean? But really, why Orlean? Listen to what the verse says. No one seems to understand that God is protecting them from the disasters to come. So she's gone too soon. But let us really ask God the real why. Protecting. I don't know what was coming. But the scripture said, when they die young and we don't when the young die too soon and we don't understand it, he has done nothing wrong. Because those who live godly will rest in peace with God. And Orlean, gone too soon. But God is protecting her from whatever crazy stuff was to come. And she is resting with God. God bless you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Minister Cox, I know you're just firing up, getting ready. And the question is asked, how come? But until then, I hear somebody says, I will carry on. Until then, until that day, my eyes behold that city. Beulah land. That's what we are talking about this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you so much. And coming to us at this time is Miss Beverly Campbell. And she's the aunt. Sister Beverly, make your way over. Let her feel welcome, please.
Well, good morning, everybody. Can I ask the family of Orlean to raise their hands, please? All the family members who are here, the Murdochs, the Bradshaw, the Hayes, to just raise your hand, give us a wave this morning. And the Campbells, the Campbells. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. You know, in 1976, the three of us as sisters were pregnant. And my youngest brother fathered his eldest son. And today, three of them are here. Orlean was the only girl among the group. Today, Kirk, Carl, and Marlon, they're here. And they're going to be among the pallbearers. 4 years and 6 months ago, we walked through these doors. And Arlene and Perry, we were here to celebrate with them as they were joining holy matrimony, not knowing that so soon and so short, Arlene would be taken away from us. Arlene, in our family, there are some names that are duplicated, but there was one Arlene. So when anything that said Arlene, we did not have to ask Arlene who. We know it was Arlene Campbell. You know, Arlene is from a godly family. All of Arlene's grandparents right now, without the shadow of a doubt, are around the throne of God. I don't have to ask that. I don't have to ask that. They are there. Our four grandparents are there. And I am certain when Arlene reached the pearly gate, they came out to meet Arlene. And I can hear Miss Julie saying, Arlene, you come. You know, we just want to thank God for giving us Arlene for a short time. And the credit goes to Altia. I can say Altia and Cherry. I don't have to say Brother Campbell. I can say Altia and Cherry. The praise goes to God, but the credit goes to the parents who raised such a wonderful, wonderful young lady, one who had integrity. I love Arlene like I love my own child. And when I called her, she said, Auntie, Arlene wanted to protect her parents so much that she did not tell them how sick she was, because she did not want them to go through the pain. The last time I saw Arlene, Nicole was at the hospital with Arlene, and she FaceTimed me, and Arlene said, Auntie, don't let Auntie see me looking like this. She wanted to protect everybody. But you know, I can't say everything that I want to say. But we are here, sorry, some people are here today to say good night to Arlene. But others are here to say goodbye. And you can say goodbye, you can only say good night if you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. If you don't know Him and you die in your sins, it will be goodbye. Bye forever, for you'll never see Arlene Campbell again, because she's somewhere around the throne of God. Arlene had a godly heritage, and she has set the stage very high. Young people, before I leave, I want to tell you one thing, that it pays to serve Jesus. It pays to serve Jesus. I speak from my heart. And all of these little nephews and nieces here were raised in our house, and they used to go to church. I am serving you notice. You better get back and serve your God. Arlene is a unifier. She wants to unify us. And God has used Arlene as a tool to come back to tell all of you that you need to serve Jesus. Arlene may have lost the battle, but she won the war. Because death will have no more dominion over Arlene. where Arlene is, death cannot touch her anymore. And another thing I want to say, Arlene is only sleeping. Arlene is not dead, but she's only sleeping. And Arlene, because I know that you're sleeping, my dear Arlene, my child Arlene, you're only sleeping. Rest in peace. Rest in peace, Arlene. Rest in peace, Arlene. And may light perpetually shine.
Thank you so much, Aunt. A life so beautifully lived and a heart so deeply loved. Coming to us at this time is Miss Patricia Emmanuel, and she'll be offering a tribute. Let her feel welcome, please.
Greet the house pastor and all the pastors in the house, the clergies, all the members of the church, friends and family. I'd like to greet my uncle Altman Campbell, my auntie Lydia Campbell, my cousin Dwight Campbell, and last but not least, Perry Davis. I am here, we are here representing family from England and Spain, the Campbell family from England, and the Williams family from Spain. We've got lots of family in Jamaica. There are lots of family from Jamaica here as well. So yes, them too. I must say that Arlene is somebody who, when you meet her, you'd never forget her. Because of the distance that we live, the times that I've seen Arlene, no matter how wide the gap was, when I meet her, she would be the same person, no change. Arlene has a smile that lights up a room. You would be talking to her and she would be engaging. Her eyes would be looking into your eyes. That tells you, yes, I'm here, I'm listening to what you're saying. Arlene was so unselfish. Even in her last days, I was told that she was so brave. Even when she was in pain, she didn't really let on too much because she didn't want her parents and her husband and her brother to grieve and to have too much worries. So she would keep most of it to herself. Arlene is so loved. She is a special niece, and I can say it from my Auntie Winnie in Spain and my dad, Philip, and my Uncle Caleb in England as well. There are so many nieces and nephews, but when they speak about Arlene, there was that special thing about Arlene, her sincerity, her grace. And one of the reasons as well is because she's the firstborn of their youngest brother, Altman. So she was so special. Even when I speak to Auntie Winnie, she would say, I still can't believe it. It hasn't sunk in yet. So sometimes we have to say, the scripture tells us so many things that can pacify us, because it says that the foolishness of man, the foolishness of God is wiser than man. So we don't know why he's taken Arlene so from us so early. And it's really painful to know that she left at such a young age. But we don't have to feel any way to cry, because Jesus did weep when Lazarus was dead. So we have to, she's left a legacy for us that we have to strive, as our sister Beverly Campbell said, that we should strive to seek God so that one day we will see her in the pearly gate. Arlene and everyone, I mean, Everyone, parents, friends, and everyone, let us not mourn as those without hope, because we have a hope, because blessed are those who die in the Lord. So, Arlene Grace Campbell Davis, may your soul rest in eternal peace until we meet again. God bless you all.
Thank you so much. At this time, we're going to just pause from our tribute, and we're going to be worshiping with our giving or offering, and we're going to be singing a very well-known song, one of the favorite of our dear departed sister. Whenever she led us in praise and worship, this was one of her popular songs. Jehovah is your name. And we're going to ask you to worship with us. And of course, if she was here, she'd have liked to know that you did worship with your offering. So take us away here, praise and worship.
Jehovah is your name.
I just paused the song just because I've been asked if we can take a collection electronically. And I forgot to have mentioned to you, for those of you who would like to make your contribution by Zelle, you could Zelle to, there it is, DCWC 4140 at gmail.com. There it is, DCWC 4140 at gmail.com. You could just do that now on your electronic device. And if you so desire that you want to pay by charge, you can see us after. And so we'll just continue one more verse. So reminiscent of our dear departed sister. Jehovah is your name. Coming to us in an expression of dance is our DCWC Youth Ministry. And as you have learned before, this ministry was all started by our dear departed sister, Orlene Campbell Davis. After the youth ministry has made their expressions, I'll be opening the floor for two or three open tributes. Just about three. And you'll be confined to the time, just as what I mentioned before. But at this time, I'd like for you to make welcome our youth ministry as they make their contribution. Thank you.
to show their appreciation to Sister Orlean, the DCWC Dance Ministry. Our dancers would like you to know that Sister Orlean has played a very important part in their development, and to show their love and appreciation, they wanted to choose a song that connected them or connects them with Sister Orlean. So today, the last song she danced with them is a song that they will be ministering to today. God bless you.
Will your heart and soul say yeah, yeah? Will your spirit still say yes? If I told you what I really
saying there's more that I require of.
He's calling you higher. There is more that I require of thee. He said, don't be afraid of men and their faces. Don't be afraid, don't be afraid, don't be afraid.
Speaking of legacy, certainly she has left much with us, indelible indeed. At this time, I'd like to open the floor just for one or two short tributes. If there's anyone burning with a tribute, we'll allow you to do that just now. Just tell us who you are.
Hello, everyone. My name is Layton. I'm Orlean's cousin. I'm Daniel's sister. And I'm nervous. Okay. Danielle's my sister. I'm her brother. Dwight. I see you, cuz, and I understand everything you're saying. I had the opportunity to see Orlean at the end of January, and despite everything, you know, she was still Orlean. And for me, it's, you know, it's hard, but I know for my sister, Orlean was more like a sister to her than anything. They were more than cousins, they were sisters. And I just want to tell everybody here that she will be missed. I love her dearly. And I'll see you again, Orlean.
Amen. Here comes Dad.
It's a sad day for us. I just want to greet you all in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We are mourning, but we're mourning, not mourning like those that have no hope. We know that our daughter is going to be with the Lord, and we will see her again. Yes, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I know she has set the bar real high for me. Yeah. And so I'll have to strive. By the grace of God, we will make it in. And we will be together again. Where there will be no more death, no more sorrow, no more pain. I just want to share with you this dream that I got. Just about, it could have been about 8 weeks ago. And I told it to her. I dreamt that we were visiting with her. You know, we're living in the city of Winter Haven. And I dreamt that we were visiting with her. And she said, let us go to church. I said, okay. But the pathway to the church was across a long and narrow bridge. It could have been about half of a mile long. It was just about 30 inches wide. But it was kind of scary because there was no guardrail. And as we entered the bridge, we saw a group of people there. I stooped down because in real life, I'm scared of height. Yes, and I stooped down. But she stepped across from everybody. She didn't look back. And she bravely stepped across that bridge, straight across. And across the bridge, there was this beautiful, magnificent building. And with stained glass windows, and the lights were glowing on the inside. And she stepped across and she went over to that building. And it reminds me of the song, Across the Bridge, There's No More Sorrow. Across the bridge, there's no more pain. The sun will rise, shine across that river, and we'll never be unhappy again. And I'm sure we are going to see her again. Yeah. She was such a loving and caring daughter, I can tell you that. You know, loving, gentle, kind, you know, compassionate. And, you know, we are going to miss her so much, you know. Sometimes when she called, you know, she would say, her greetings was like this, Daddy, Mommy, Wagwan. What's going on? Yes, going on. And then sometimes she would say, how you do? Instead of how are you doing, she would say, how you do? And as Jamaicans, we know that's a loving way of saying it, you know. And we're going to miss her, but I know that we'll see her again. She's going to be with our Lord. And I would say this to all of us, that tomorrow is not promised to any one of us. Yes, yes. Life is a serious thing. And like I said before, in life we should have fun and enjoy ourselves in the Lord. But life in itself is very serious. It's not just for living like some might say. Yeah, God placed us here to serve him, to live for him. Yes, because we don't know when we're going to depart. And so we must make sure where we are going to spend our eternity. God bless you all. And we hope to see her again someday. Yeah.
Okay, good morning. I'm Cousin Paul Campbell, and here I have my sister Ken Reese and Devin, and my second mom, Alice Black Campbell. My dad is not here, but he's here virtually watching. Hey, Dad. And if the folks who know my dad, if he was here, we'll probably need like an hour just for him to get. So I'm going to condense that down to probably 30 seconds. My dad had a special bond with Arlene, and this goes back to 1976 on Cherry. Right? So before, when Aunt Cherry was pregnant and Uncle Alty informed my dad, he looked at Aunt Cherry and said, you know, you're going to have a very special child, a very powerful child. So days after, weeks after, months after, he was trying to figure out what name could I connect to this very special and powerful child. And the name Arlene came about. He named her Arlene because he saw this as a beautiful, flowered child that's going to have all that power, which we've heard about, you know, when the pastor was mentioning everything she did. I was joking in my head saying, in Jamaica, they talk about you have to have 9 jobs. And she exceeded that 9 job. She exceeded her time in the amount of things that she delivered on this earth. Last night, I was also reflecting, saying, my God, I wish I could get 10% of what she did and the attention that she here. And if I get 10%, I did great. Yeah. I did great. So, you know, when I listened and I looked at all the tribute, someone said, where's the lie? Where's the lie? That's right. And there's no lie. I can confirm there's no lie. There's no lie. So going back to my dad, growing up as a young child, she lived at her house. And that bond that they had, he treated her just like one of us, to the point where that was her uncle, but she called him Dad. So she coined him Uncle Daddy. Right? Right? Uncle Daddy, because that's what she knew as uncle, but just like us, it was also her dad. Years after my dad decided to open a bus company in Jamaica, guess what he named it? Uncle Daddy. And today, if he drives from St. Mary to Kingston, people, Uncle Daddy, you're good? So his legacy is known as Uncle Daddy. But remember, I started by saying she was special, powerful. She's going to touch lives. And how she touched his life, not only with that bond, but naming him Uncle Daddy. Remember part of the story? He named her, and she named him. So now today, he's known as Uncle Daddy throughout Jamaica. So we heard all those powerful things that she has done. She touched his life also, right? So in closing, because I know the clock is ticking, I cried several times, but I'm done crying. I'm celebrating because I'm not a full-blown religious person, meaning I don't go to church every day. Please, God, forgive me. But the one thing I believe is that she's in a much better place than we are today. She's in a place that I aspire to go, right? And I was sitting there saying, man, I have a busy life, not as busy as she did. And, you know, I do things on the weekends where my job requires me to be at, you know, the restaurant that I operate. And I'm saying to myself, what lame excuse do I have for not going to church? So, Uncle, Aunt Arlene, in the next 2 weeks, I will be in church because it's the right thing for me to do. It's the right thing for me to do. Thank you for leaving that legacy for me.
I must say, ta-ta, bye-bye, beautiful smiles. I love you, Arlene. Have a blessed one, because God has given to you your life for so long, and I know it is ta-ta, bye-bye. We'll meet on the other side. As I tell you that the Lord is down by River Jordan, he's waiting there to scoop you up, my darling. Pretty smiles, lovely dimples. Everybody knows. Ta-ta, bye-bye. Don't you? Yeah. Yes, because we are Jamaican. So, me don't know much English, you know, but me can chat like a patois, don't it? Anyway, I can say she was what she was, and we all loved her with all our heart. Have a blessed day.
Thank you. We're going to be taking the last one, and for those who did not get the opportunity, we're going to be asking you, just wait until the repast later on. We will have open floor, and at that time, please prepare to make your tribute. This is the last one.
Good morning, everybody. I got the sad news on Facebook, and I called my brother right away. He didn't answer the phone. I couldn't believe it. I went to work the next day, told my manager, look, I'm not coming to work. My sister passed away. I'm not. But I'm going to take it from baby days. Me and my twin sister, she's right there. When we're on the roof of the house playing, Dwight would tell you, we always have Arlene looking out. It was me, Dwight, and Layton. Always looking out. Any bus. Sometimes she missed the bus. Mr. Campbell come home. Hey, you all right? Yeah, yeah. Then what he did, took out his belt. Wah, wah, wah. Stay off the roof. Stay off the roof. Stay off the roof. And every time we get whooping, we still whoop Arlene again because she's the reason why we get whooped. But to my sister, you're in a better place. No more pain. No more sorrow. But I want everybody to look. Who's the next person? Who's the next person? If nobody give their life to the Lord, give it. Because this right here is a road for everybody. Whether you like it or not, it is. Have a nice day. God bless you.
Thank you, sir. No more Uncle Daddy. No more up on the roof. But but coming to us at this time to tell us more in remembrance, aka eulogy. We're going to be calling on Miss Shelly Ann Campbell to come forward and tell us more. Let her feel welcome, please.
Good afternoon. Got me. All right. So on behalf of the Campbell, the Murdoch, and Davis family, I would like to express our gratitude to everyone today. And to those who share their condolences, we have been overwhelmed by the numerous calls, messages, flowers, visits, and prayers we have received. These gestures have provided us comfort during the challenging time and serve as a reminder of the profound impact Orlean had on many lives. Orlean Grace Campbell Davis was born in Kingston, Jamaica on June 5th, 1976. She was the eldest child of Altiman and Lydia Campbell, followed by her only sibling, Dwight. Orlean attended Portmore Prep before advancing to St. Jude's High School for girls. She spent 16 years of her early life in Jamaica before migrating to the United States with her family. For about 8 years, Orlean, her brother, and parents reside in Hicesville, Maryland, where they embarked in a new chapter. I vividly recall her reminiscing about the cold days in Maryland and her friends she missed dearly. It was there that she completed high school education as an exceptional student with a promising future. Due to the unbearable cold weather, her parents had made a decision to relocate to Florida. Orlean continued her academic pursuits there. Orlean, a compassionate individual, decided to pursue a social work degree at Florida Atlantic University, dedicating herself to improving the lives of others. She embodied the role of a giver, a nurturer, a listener, a motivator, and soft-spoken advocate. In 2008, she attained her master's degree in social work from Barry University. Fully embracing her passion for assisting others, her adopted sister, Danielle, and her adopted mom, Sister Jean, and numerous other remarkable individuals can attest to the impact she had on their lives. Driven by her determination to become a licensed professional, Orlean remembers her studies amidst the 2020 pandemic. Joining study groups, she committed herself to daily sessions before work, several consecutive months tirelessly striving to achieve her aspirations. In 2021, Orlean triumphantly succeeded at becoming a licensed clinical social worker. This achievement filled her with immense pride and sentiment shared by those who knew and admired her. However, in the year 2022, Orlean health took a turn for the worst, altering the course of her life. Characterized in her well-being above all else, she faced the challenges that lied ahead with resilience and determination to get better. With a positive mind and God as her healer, she battled with all her might, relying on grace, prayer, and a multitude of supporters. The Davis Community Church become an integral part of her existence, had a special place in her heart. She was a significant part, it was a significant part of her life. She took on roles such as a choir director, a praise dance instructor. It was also the place where she exchanged vows and got married. Today, we gather here to honor her life and remember the impact she made. Arlene's faith was established at a young age, and from then on, she dedicated herself to God and serving others. To truly understand Arlene, one must understand the importance of her parents in her life. They meant everything to her, and they did just about everything together until they retired and relocated to Winter Haven, Florida. To Arlene's parents, I know for certain we don't lose the people we love, not even death. They continue to participate in every act, thought, and decision we make. In 2012, Arlene met David Perry Davis, and their love led them to exchange vows in 2019. They were blessed with 4 years of marriage. Throughout their journey, Perry remains a constant source of support. I remember a conversation I had with Arlene one Friday night, just before she went into the hospital. Perry was headed off to work, but he made sure to leave everything she needed to be comfortable. She turned to me and said, Perry truly lived out his vows. Perry, we thank you for being the rock that Arlene needed, and we commend you for the unwavering support. Arlene cherished her brother with all her heart, always protecting and supporting him. She goes in peace, knowing that you will hold on the fort for her in her absence. She will always be proud of you, both in this life and the next. A heartfelt thank you goes out to Arlene's co-workers, her colleagues, who are always understanding and supportive. She often spoke highly of you, emphasizing how special you were to her. God saw you tired, and a cure was not to be. So he put his arms around you and whispered, "Come with me." With tearful eyes, we watched you slowly fade away. Although we loved you dearly, we could not make you stay. A golden heart stopped beating, your hard-working hands put to rest. God broke our hearts deeply to prove to us he only takes the best. On March 9th, 24, surrounded by loved ones, Arlene peacefully closed her eyes. Let us remember Arlene for her lightheartedness, her happiness, her elegantness, her fictitious smile, her love, her sincerity, her thoughtfulness, for a life filled with great significant wisdom and purpose. We hold you dearly, Arlene. You were a devoted spouse, a beloved daughter, a cherished cousin, a protective sister, an awesome aunt, a loved niece, and most of all, a great friend. Till we meet again, we love you. We will forever miss you. May your soul rest in peace.
Thank you so much. So ably read. It's a time when we will be calling upon our church choir, the Davie Community Worship Center. And they've been singing a song that reminds us when we wake up in glory. A song where unto Jesus we will be singing redemption story. We all will have a story for the one who has redeemed us by his grace. And so at this time, I'd like for you to sit back and relax as our David Community Worship Center will now offer a rendition. don't know if you can visualize in the mind's eye when you wake up in glory, singing redemption story. And you know who you're going to be singing it to? Jesus Christ. That was indeed joyful singing. And I will also go a little bit further in saying that it was seraphic in nature. So very well done. I thank you so much. And quite a number of our choirs have not been around and due to various reasons. And one of our leaders, Sister Jean Farragan, she had an accident just in recent days. And she's here today singing. Sister Banton, I've seen you in your usual place again. Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you so much, so much. Well, it is time for the word. And we're asking our good Lord for words of comfort. Words of comfort that will come from his manservant. And it is our prayer that the lips of our asking will meet the lips of his giving. Congregation, I present to you the man of God, Bishop Dr. Fedlin A. Beeson, one who is very well known in the ecclesiastical circle, one who has served extremely well in the Church of God. I must say the apex of Church of God hierarchy, International, Church of God International. And I just like to let you make him feel welcome, please.
Thank you so much, Elder McLeod. Greetings to everyone. As I sat by, I wondered if most of those who spoke so well of our departed daughter, if they knew that she was a member of the Church of God in Kingston, Jamaica for donkey's years before she really reached here. I baptized her as a little girl. I knew her before she was born. Knew her from she was in her mother's womb. Christened her as a baby, as it were. Baptized her as a little girl. And I wonder why they didn't have that particular photograph on the screen when I baptized her. But that is the most precious one. If you were to get a copy of that, it would cost about $1,000. Indeed, it's good to be here. And Elder McLeod, thank you so very much. I have just a few minutes to share a portion of God's word with you. And sometimes I believe that times like this should be the first item on the program instead of the last one. But certainly, the Bible tells us in Revelation chapter 14, Revelation 14, verses 12 and 13. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus Christ. Verse 13. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write it down so that you won't forget it. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. From henceforth, yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works will continue. The blessed dead. I cannot understand if the dead can be blessed. But this is what the Word of God said. There's a special blessing for certain people, not all dead. The blessed dead. One of the most frequently used
word in the New Testament scripture is blessed. I repeat, one of the most frequently used words in the New Testament scriptures is the word blessed. And when blessed is applied to God, it has the synergy of praise and adoration. When you apply blessed to God, it has the substance of praise and adoration. And when blessed is applied to human, it denotes a state of happiness, joy and comfort, and everlasting peace. If you are blessed as a human, you are blessed indeed. Do you hear me? When applied to human, it denotes a state of happiness, joy and comfort, and everlasting peace. This word blessed is used in the pagan Greek literature to describe the state of happiness and a state of well-being, such as what is enjoyed by God's word straight from the book. But more so, in the sacred pages of the Holy Scriptures, the word blessed is given a very strong spiritual content, such as what is revealed in the Beatitudes of our Lord in the Gospel of St. Matthew chapter 5, and elsewhere, such as in St. Luke chapter 1 and St. John chapter 20 and James chapter 1 and verse 12. The word blessed also seems to contain a very profound amount of congratulatory divine elements. Blessed seem to contain a very profound amount of congratulatory divine evidence and elements as a note of praise from the Almighty God Himself. If God blesses you, nobody can curse you. It doesn't make sense you try to curse anyone who God blesses. You're wasting time. You're wasting time. If God blesses someone, forget it, he's blessed. And you cannot curse who God blessed. You're wasting time. So you're wasting time trying to curse some of us. We are blessed already by the Almighty God. You are wasting time trying to hate somebody whom God has blessed. You may as well love the person whom God blessed. Because if God bless you, no man can curse you. My brothers and sisters who are blessed of God may sometimes outwardly looked upon as to be pitied. You may look on a saint, one who is blessed, and believe he need to be pitied. But from the higher and truest standpoint, the blessed people are really to be envied rather than pitied. They are to be coveted and congratulated and imitated rather than pitied. Those of you who pity Christians and sorry for them, you are better off loving them and congratulate them. Do you understand me? Such word as blessed in its verbal, such word as blessed in its verbal and substantive forms are only uttered by God and Jesus Christ himself. Only those persons can bless. God and Jesus Christ alone. Such as God himself in the Old Testament scriptures and our Lord as in the Beatitudes. You know that very well. And as the apostle declared in Romans chapter 9, the apostle declared in Romans 9 and the verse 5 that there are those in the flesh whom God has blessed. And once you are blessed by God, you are blessed forever. As the apostle declared in the epistle of Ephesians chapter 1, verses 2 to 3. Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Look at verse 4 of that text. According as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, listen, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. But look at verse 5. Having predestinated us, the Almighty God, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his good will. Did you hear me? Look at verse 6. To the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he has made us accepted in the beloved family. That beloved family is the family of our Lord Jesus Christ. But look at verse 7. In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. Amen. My friends, blessings according to the Old Testament scriptures generally denote a bestowal of good pleasure indeed. Denote a certain amount of divine attention when you are blessed. And according to our text here, listen, it is very powerful indeed when one is blessed of God. Look at the text I read. According to the text here, is the fortitude of God's people. God's blessings is the fortitude of God's people who have been kept by power divine, who have been kept by the grace of God, who remain faithful to the Almighty God until death. You shall be specially blessed. Our text says here is the reward of the saints who have kept the commandments of God. Listen, here is the reward of the saints who have kept the commandments of God. The apostle writer of our text says, I heard a voice from heaven. He was praying and he fell in a trance. I'd ever prayed until you get out of your flesh and get in the spirit. Maybe most of you, the reach of my voice, don't understand the term. But there comes a time when you kneel down to pray and the Holy Spirit saturates you. You come out of your self flesh and you get into a spirit world. Hallelujah, where the Holy Spirit begins to minister to you. I know this sounds strange to some of you, but that's what happens when the Holy Spirit takes over your prayer. Amen. And construct your prayer in a heavenly way to the Almighty God. It's the Holy Spirit who then takes over your prayer. Amen. And create a new sentence. I know this is strange to you, but don't be surprised if you hear a Christian praying and end up in hallelujah and glory and praise God and shouting, oh, you better give me a break. When I'm praying and the Holy Spirit takes over, my wife doesn't understand. I begin to speak in languages that she cannot interpret. It is the Holy Spirit that takes over. And yet the writer said while he was praying, he heard a voice from heaven. Had you ever heard the voice of God? I heard a voice from heaven. Which of you at the reach of my voice ever heard God's voice? Think about it. Which of you at the reach of my voice, a thousand of you worshiping from all over the world. There's a big group now in Australia and in the Philippines and in England and through the Caribbean that now tuning to this program. Listen to me. Which of you had ever prayed until you hear the voice of God? Is anybody at the reach of my voice ever heard God's voice? The apostle writer of our text says, I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write down what I'm going to say to you, because it is not a nonsense story I'm going to tell you. So go get your pen and a piece of paper. I have something to tell you, but I don't want you to forget it, so you've got to write it down. So get your paper and your notebook and write on your pen and parchment and listen. Write it down What is it? Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Write it down. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, said the Holy Ghost, that they may rest from their labors, rest from their suffering, and their works will continue. All in work will continue, because the group that danced a while ago is our work. So our work will continue. Let me tell you something. There's a lady sitting on the platform here in the choir who was one of those who spoke, said she was one of Orlean's second mother. Her name is Jean Ferrigan. Very close to her. Amen. I mean, very close. And she was assistant to Jean, for Jean Ferrigan is the choir missus, and Orlean Campbell was assistant. And listen here, Orlean Campbell passed on. Jean became very distorted. She couldn't grasp it. She didn't understand it. So she was driving her car, coming from a preparation service for Orlean's old ongoing service. And her car got out of control and crashed in a wall, climbed up on the wall. They had to use something like a crane to take the car off the wall. Jean is sitting in church today. The car is written off. Wait, don't cheer yet, because you're going to have to cheer again. Amen. And while the car was on the wall and Jean was unconscious, listen to me good, Jean was unconscious. The police came and shook her and called her and brought her back to consciousness and said, give me a phone number that I can call. Let me call and tell somebody what happened to you. And Jean says she heard them, but she didn't have any phone number to give them. All of a sudden, she saw a phone number appear on the wall. And she quote that number, telephone number, to the police. Do you know whose number that was? Orlean's number. Orlean's number. And the police call Orlean's number. Do you know who answered? Orlean's husband. You don't understand what I'm talking about. When the Holy Ghost takes over, a lot of things can go on, you know. Amen. And when the police called the number, that was what set the ball a playing. Something we don't understand with this thing called death. There's something. I know there's something about that. I know that there's something about death you do not understand. But as time goes on, we are going to understand. By and by. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? Write it down. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Blessed. Write this down. Happy are the dead who die in the Lord. Amen. Now from henceforth, saith the Holy Spirit, they carry with them their record, and their work will continue. May I tell you something? Listen good now for the next couple of minutes. You have a record. I don't know what your record is, but everybody has a record. And when you die, your record is not dead. Your record is not dead. Now from henceforth, says the Holy Spirit, for they carry with them their record. The record of their deeds, says the New English Bible. My friends, in this world of dying, there is a divinely declared distinction between the righteous dead and the unrighteous dead. Our dead are not the same. You have righteous dead and unrighteous dead. You have dead who die like brute beasts. You cannot live like a brute beast and die like an angel of God. Forget it. I had a little, there's a little girl in Jamaica, said, forget it. You cannot live like a brute beast and die like an angel. And so you live, so you die, and so you're going to be brought back to life and face your Almighty God. You live like a brute beast, you die like one, you shall be brought back to life like one, and stand before the Almighty God like one. Yes. our text says, here is the reward of the saints who have kept the commandments of God. Write down this. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. From henceforth, yea, saith the Spirit, for they kept their rest from their labor, but they carry their deeds with them. My friends, in this world of dying, there's a divinely declared destination between the righteous dead and the unrighteous dead. All deads are not the same. Believers in Christ in this world of the dying, who are one by one passing away, are evidently placed in a class by themselves, by the Holy Spirit, in a different category. The righteous dead and the unrighteous dead, they are in different categories. As dying in the Lord is not a vague or vain, empty expression of human vocabulary. Dying in the Lord is a profound statement, because you cannot live like the devil and die in the Lord. I wish I could preach. Dying in the Lord is an expression that defines. Dying in the Lord is an expression, amen, that differentiates the dead and put them in a different category, put them in a different class. They may be buried beside each other in the same cemetery, but trust me, they are different. Dying in the Lord is an expression that identifies and categorizes. Amen. Such dying in the Lord includes, if conversion, you had to be living in the Lord to be able to die in the Lord. I repeat, you cannot live in Satan and die in Jesus Christ. Dying in the Lord includes the serving of the Lord and abiding by his word. Such includes walking with the Lord and talking with the Lord and worshiping God Almighty. That's what living for God means. And oh dear saints of God, it seems most naturally that the voice that spoke to John in his revelation was this very same messenger who directed the vision that he had. Such voice could well be the voice of Jesus Christ. Amen. My friends, blessings are the promised covenant of God the Almighty, Sovereign One, from the very beginning of time. Blessings, amen, are the covenant of Almighty God to the human family from the beginning of time. God had never meant to curse anyone. Did you hear me, my friends? Blessings are the promised covenant of God, the Almighty, Sovereign One, from the very beginning of time, according to Genesis chapter 1 and the verses 27 to 31. So God created human in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, man and woman. He said, he created them, you know. God Almighty, if I could only preach God's word before I die. If I had a chance to preach, I would holler. You don't understand me. According to Genesis chapter 1 and the verses 27 to 31. So God created human in his own image. In the image of God, he created them male and female, man and woman. And verse 28 says, and God blessed them. It's long time God blessing people. So God blessing is not only going to be in the next world. From the beginning of time, in the book of Genesis, the word of God said, God created them and blessed them and told them to multiply and replenish and control things and keep things in order. God Almighty blessed man from Genesis. From the beginning of time, he blessed them. And can I tell you a little more? God blessed them and told them to multiply, You know, multiply means multiply. Jesus Christ told us to multiply. Two men can't multiply. Nobody not praying for me. Jesus Christ, two women cannot multiply. It's a man and woman multiply. God. Listen to me. Two men cannot multiply. It is a plan of Satan when he put two men together. It's a plan of Satan to mash up the human family. Anybody praying for me? I better leave this alone and go on with the word of the Lord. Hallelujah. But God blessed them and told them to multiply. Multiplication came from a man and a woman. And I know I'm all over the world. Hallelujah. God blessed them and told them must multiply and replenish the earth. Fill it up. Curse came upon the human family as a result of disobedience. And it came once and it will come again. For whatever was wrong in garden, in the garden, Eden of garden, is wrong today. God has not changed. What was wrong in the days of Sodom and Gomorrah is still wrong today. God has not changed. What was sin yesterday for God is still sin today. God has not changed. There's somebody here that God Almighty wants to hear this message. That's why I'm Titekum. That's why I'm call his daughter home. Because that's the only way you could have heard this message is when he call his daughter home. So he had a plan. The cycle of curse began after man's sin. Then came, amen, Cain killed his brother and buried him in the ground. I hid him in the ground, and God stayed in heaven and saw what he did. And God came down and said, where is your brother? And the backslider told God that he don't know. And God said, well, I, your brother's blood, crying. I never know that blood can cry. Your brother's blood is crying out from the ground. And I heard it in heaven. So I come down to tell you to tell me, what have you done with your brother? Because your brother's blood. Are those people who shedding human blood and allowing human blood to stay in the ground? God, blood has a language. And only God can understand the language that blood has spoken. God said your brother's blood has cried out to me. And I've come down to see what you have done with him. Hallelujah. Blood has a language like tears. When you cry, tears has a language. Only God understands the vocabulary. Amen. Of tears and blood. My God Almighty is talking to this end time generation. The cycle of sin continued after Cain killed his brother. According to Genesis chapter 11. Verses 1 to 9. Then God, the sovereign one, began a new series of blessings upon humanity through Abraham. Are you hearing me? According to Genesis chapter 12. A series of blessings. And this is a new beginning. Hear this before you go. This is a new beginning of divine eternal blessings upon Adam's fallen sin-doomed race. That, amen, that caused Jacob, blessed Jacob, and the blessings of Jacob spread to the entire family, and the blessings of salvation that is brought to us, the human race through Jesus Christ, the Redeemer. Blessings start again. And saints of God, this everlasting eternal blessing is promised to all those who are obedient to God's word and keep his covenant. Amen. And death has nothing to do with your relationship with God. I never heard that song. Oh, Lord. I never heard that song that has always been sung. Amen. What love got to do with it? I never heard it. If you never heard it, go look up its CD and buy it and play it. Ask your smartphone to play it. What love got to do with it? Well, let me ask you something. You need to find out what death got to do with the relationship with you and Almighty God. Death has nothing to do with your relationship. Nothing. Death cannot change your relationship with Jesus Christ. Yeah, tell you, death cannot change Arlene's relationship. The Bible said, whether she live or whether she die, she's the Lord's. Glory to God. Is God body that? Hallelujah. God is responsible for Arlene. You don't understand me. And in the fullness of time, God is going to call her. Saints of God, this everlasting eternal blessing is promised to all those who are obedient to God. Are you obedient to God's word? Are you serving God? This gospel must be preached because here the Apostle John declared that in his vision he saw an angel flying in the midst of the heavens, having an everlasting gospel to preach unto them who dwell upon the face of the earth. And this gospel must be preached, listen, to every nation and kindred and tongue and people everywhere. People, this everlasting gospel is the signification of the profound expression throughout the New Testament scriptures. That is the eternal, amen, the eternal word of Almighty God. Everybody must hear the word of God. If you don't hear, it is your business, but God has made plan for you to hear. All pigmen, whether you're black, you're white, or you're polka dot. Your color has not changed God's word. It doesn't matter who you are. Black, white, or polka dot. All pigmen, all nation. There's one sovereign, everlasting God. One redeemer, Jesus Christ. And one gospel. Whether you're intelligent or you're an hypocrite, it doesn't matter who you are. Whether you go to college or not. Amen. It's the same gospel for you. God not preaching up any gospel for you. Amen. It's one gospel, one God, one Jesus Christ. Oh, glory. So I do have a gospel for the white man, and one for the black man, and one for the educated, and one for the illiterate. One gospel, one God, one blood. Same one. Hallelujah. Which is eternal redeeming gospel. The gospel is the eternal redeeming gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And the synergy of this eternal gospel is to portray the certainty of everlasting life to those who believe in Jesus Christ. That is the substance and the energy and the virtue and the synergy of the gospel, is to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen to me. And this everlasting gospel of blessedness is unalterable. It cannot be altered. And it is eternal. It in its nature and contents, it is eternal. And you cannot alter it or paraphrase it. This scripture states in very profound and heart-searching language that no change from life can separate a child of God from the Lord Jesus Christ. No change. Whether you live or you die, you belong to the Lord. All in belong to the Lord God. The word of God tells us in the epistles of Romans chapter 8 and the verse 35 that nothing, absolutely nothing, did you hear me? I said it is in Romans chapter 8, set it down. Amen. And you have any smartphone, if your phone is smart, tell it to set it down. So that when you go home, tell your smartphone to preach back to you what the preacher say. Since him smart, him should have sense to understand, say, what the preacher say. Anybody hear me? Oh, I'm under the passion of Almighty God to preach his word. No change of life from life to death can affect the Christian's relationship between Christ and himself. No change. The word of God tells us, listen good, smartphone. The word of God tells us in the epistles of Romans chapter 8 and the verse 35 that nothing, absolutely nothing, shall separate the Christian from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus Christ. You hear me, man? Nothing. Listen, I'm not done. Neither is me done. Neither tribulation nor distress. Anybody at the reach of my voice passing through some trouble sometimes? Not only you. There are others who are going through distress. Distress cannot separate you from the love of God. Hallelujah. He is not done. Neither tribulation, nor distress, nor persecution. They can tell all the lie they want to tell on the Christians. It shall not separate you from the love of God. Nor persecution, nor hunger, nor nakedness, nor perils, nor sword. Listen to me. You see, you hear the apostle. I am persuaded that neither death nor angel. I'm persuaded. I'm certain. And I am convinced of what he said. Neither death nor angel. I'm not done. Neither am I done. Nor principalities. Nor powers. Nor things present. Nor things to come. None of them. Look at verse 39. Neither height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah, somebody. Why not somebody give the Lord a cheer? Put your hands together and clap him. Clap Jesus. Clap him. Before you go, take this little one here. Let's look at death. Put on your glasses and take a glance at death. Father Mina, this wicked, cold-blooded monster is that I'm talking about. So you may as well say amen, because I'm so meet you too. Let us glance at death. This wicked, cold-blooded, cruel monster that is merciless and mean, which is the most certain of all things. The most certain of all things, you know. Amen. For it is appointed for human to die. Amen. And we cannot bribe death. We cannot send him next door. We can't tell him to go to auntie or cousin or brother. You cannot bribe him. You cannot turn him down. You have an appointment. Everybody at the reach of my voice, you have an appointment with death. And that is an appointment you must keep. So it doesn't matter how you're nice and sweet. You have an appointment with death. But according to the word of God, which should not be overlooked, amen, that it is appointed unto human once to die. But listen to me now. After death, if you're dead, you're not done. My late mother lived at home with Esmond and myself. I think I don't know where I was. Maybe I was in Australia or some. I was far away. I traveled for 15 hours. I served the church in 168 countries of the world. And I was far away when my wife called and told me that my mother was dying. I said, try and keep her till I come. But by the time I took flight, several hours and reached Los Angeles. 15 hours flight to Los Angeles, then 5 hours from Los Angeles to Miami, 1 hour from Miami to Jamaica. By the time I reached her, Mama was gone. And my wife met me at the door and said, she's gone. We just cover up on the bed, but she's gone. I said, take me to the room. My wife took me to the room. I felt her. She was cold as ice. I called my son. I said, bring me a mirror. You put the mirror over her nose. And if she's not dead, it will sort of frost up, for she's breathing. I put it there, nothing come on. I said, Mama dead? I said, Mama! I called mama. Listen to me, people. I called until my wife thought I was getting mad. But I called for about 5 minutes until mama answered me. She answered me. And she came and she said, you called me, Brother Fred. She said, Brother Fred, you come. She said, I couldn't wait on you, you know. I was in a far country, but I heard when you're calling me, and I come back just to hear what you have to say. That's my wife. She's sitting here. She came back and she chatted with me for about 5 minutes and went again. Gone back to the far country. There is something that you don't understand. There is something about death you don't understand. You and I will not understand. But there's a blessing that awaits those who die in the Lord. Oh, could I take this down and pull the curtains down? While death is a biological necessity that should be expected by every person. But everyone must know human beings don't die like animals. Animals die and they are finished. Human die, they are not finished. Because of the appointment you have, it is appointed unto human once to die. And after death, is a judgment. You're going to come back to meet God. I do not know what life you live. You must know the life you live. But my friends, God is not mocked. God cannot be mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Whatsoever a person soweth, that shall he also reap. This text I must observe it closely. It is absolutely necessary for us to understand that you cannot mock God. Whatever you sow, you're going to. Sowing and reaping is referring to a time of harvest. And what I have read, well, I grew up on my father's farm. He was a big farmer. The reaping always be more than the sowing. One grain of gungo peas, one big tree and a lot of gungo. One grain of corn, sometimes two, three here and out of the, you will reap more than what you sow. You live like a wretch. You're going to die as a wretch. And your reaping as a wretch is going to be terrible. If you know what I know, you better repent now. Right now and say to God, I'm sorry for the sins that I've committed. I'm asking you to forgive me and blot out my transgression. Because it is as certain as day that every person shall meet God and shall answer to the deeds you have done. And whatever you reap, you're going to sow it. You cannot sow bad weed and expect to reap good weed. This is the word of Almighty God. Whatever you sow, that's what you're going to reap. Don't mock God. God cannot be mocked. You can mock me because I'm a human being. But I cannot mock God. And hear what Job said. Job, the patriarch Job, said, he declared in real prophetic terms in chapter 14 and verse 14, if a human dies, shall he live again, people? You know, the Bible said, if a man, but I have a wife here, she's very cantankerous. Wherever a man is mentioned in the Bible, may have to change it to human, else when I go home, she give me it. Very cantankerous lady. So like what you say this man, if a man dies, me have to change it to if a human. Look, if a man dies, shall he live again? The word of God tells us him in the book of 1 Thessalonians 5 verses 8 to 11. Let us who are of the day be sober, live good, put on the breastplate of righteousness, and live according to the word of God. For God has not appointed us to destruction, but he has appointed us to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ, man. Come on, my brothers and sisters. Screw your head and your shoulders properly now. Change your life you live because you have to meet God. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. The full blessings of God upon his children shall be from this time onward. And let us pull the shutters down. From now on, you are blessed. The time that is long for us come. Saints of God, the eternal blessings of God's children is imminent and most certain. You shall be blessed. And this blessedness that is waiting for Arlene is going to be waiting for all of us who should pass on. And if we live until he comes, we are going to be transformed. But if we die, listen what the word of God said. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Death cannot. May I say to you, husband, death has separated you and your lovely wife. Because you took the vow. I am the one who caused you to take the vow. And you said until death is done. Amen. But death does not separate us from God. And can I tell you something? We are going to see Arlene again. Our Lord spoke profoundly after Job. Job said, if a human dies, Esmond, shall he live again? Yes, hear what Job said. Yes, he will live again for all my appointed time. I am going to wait till my change comes. Hear what Job said. Job said, there's a time coming when God is going to call me. And I'm going to answer him. Now, if you're dead and done, how that happened? Job said, for all my appointed time, I'm going to wait till my change come. For God is going to call me. I never heard those people in yesteryear, those Pentecostal people, had a song to sing. When he calls me, I'll answer. I'll be somewhere listening for my name. This is what Job said. Wherever I am, when God calls me, I am going to answer. Hear what Job said. Because I know that God has him in a mind to fellowship with his creation. So although death has taken me away, God is going to call me back to life. Somewhere, you're in the grave somewhere, God is going to call you. And you're going to answer him. And he's going to give you a new life. And then the blessings of God. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. You shall be blessed forever and live forever. Nothing shall hinder you. It doesn't make sense anybody ate the blessed one. I said it on the throne, said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write these down. Blessed. He said unto me, it is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is thirsty a drink of eternal water. And he shall thirst no more, neither shall he cry any more. He shall dry our tears, and he shall pronounce eternal blessings upon us. Will you be there? Shall we bow our heads? Will you be blessed or will you be cursed? The family requested of me that before I step away from the sacred podium, I am to make an altar call. This is the family's request. And right where you are is your altar. The very position you're in is your altar. If you're not right with God, could you make it right now? Don't you allow this benediction to be pronounced before you make it right with God. The verdict is yours. If you're not a Christian and you're hoping to see Arlene again, but you're not a Christian right now, could you raise your hand? Let me see you. You're not a Christian, but you're hoping to see Arlene, but you're not a Christian. Raise your hands. I see that one. Take it down. Take it down. Take it down. I see the other one. Take it down. Yes. I don't want you to keep it up. Is there anyone else who you are not a Christian now, but you're hoping to see Arlene again? And you want to surrender to the Lord. Now God has seen those who stretch their hands. And I'm going to pray right now. The verdict is yours. You may never hear this gospel again. This may be your last portion to surrender to the Lord. and you waiting for a more convenient time, you're wasting your time. Blessed is the dead who die in the Lord. Father, Heavenly Father, I have spoken your word according to your will. There are those who surrender their hearts to you. Father, blot out their transgressions, please. Forgive their sins, O God. Sanctify them so that at the end of the day they can hear that blessedness that is promised to all those who put their trust in you. Father, breathe upon them. Blot out their transgressions, please. And forgive their sins. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. God bless you.
Thank you, Dr. Beeson. I concur. You may never hear this gospel again. I'm asked to pray for the family. But permit me just to say a quick little word about my little friend, Arlene. Sometimes I express myself a little better in writing. Let me just read this for you. To Arlene Campbell Davis, an ode, but in his voice. There are many stars in the night sky, distant bright stars and glimmering stars, but not all of them lead to a destination. Only the Bethlehem star. The Bethlehem star stood out not only because it outshone the others, but also because it bore a clear and glimmering message in the dark night sky of the Promised Land. The message was unmistakably clear, but only to those who are star readers could tell. A child is born. Somewhere in the Holy Land, but where? No one could tell. Ah, but that star, once delivered its message from above, left, never to be seen again. But who to tell? That bright star might be somewhere else, giving yet more messages of hope and joy. She was my bright star. She was my best friend and my pure delight. She was my bright angel who glows in the dark, my light at noonday and at night. Your life has told many stories that led to the Bethlehem child. When the night of my life was dark, you glowed so I could see. You are gone into eternity, but not from me. You are gone, but your light glows brighter so I can see. So my steps are surer, and my way is safer. You are gone, but never far away. Memory has no distance, and love always stays to light the way. Rest, my bright angel. You have achieved your mansion bright. Leave room for me. As you climb the stairways bright, leave room for me. I'm coming soon. Arlene means golden, the purest of metal, pure in heart and in spirit. And so to me, she will forever be. A golden girl through time and eternity, of never-changing quality, never-changing and priceless. Leave the light on for me. I'm coming soon. In the voice of her husband, Mr. Davis. I wish I had time. I did an ode for the family, but next time, not in this case. To you, as I close, I ask this question. Time, what is it? Its units are hard to measure. Sometimes they are small. Sometimes they are long. Sometimes short. Sometimes they are measured in height. And other times they are measured in width. Who knows? However they are measured, it is still time. Walking into time, I ask, how long is my time? Rebukingly, I was told that it was not for me to know, and that time is not measured by quantity, but by quality. Then I ask, how then may I prepare? Rebukingly, I was told that time is in his hand, and it was not for me to know. Pugnaciously and persistently, I ask, so how do I prepare for time? The swift answer came, time is only now. Now, can anyone of you measure now? Our Heavenly Father, I come to commit the Campbell family in your hand. I know that there are other, and the Davis family. I am so aware that it cannot be easy for you, but I come in the enabling name of Jesus Christ, the one who is able to take the heat out of the fire, even though he did not take you out of the fire. I come in the name of the one who can make hungry lion plays like a little cat, I commit you into his hand. Even in this difficult moment, that he will sustain you and make you strong. This I pray, and this I ask, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not only for the families, but for all of the friends. Amen.
I now invite the representative from Grace Funeral Chapel, and they will be giving us instructions as to the recession.
It is on behalf of this family that we've come at this time to say thanks to their friends and loved ones who've come to share with them during this, their sad hour of bereavement. We assure you that you will be thanked by this family in a more personal manner at a later date once this season has ended. But on behalf of the management and staff of Grace Funeral Chapels, we would just like to thank this family for entrusting us with the final disposition of your loved one. We don't have the power to give your wife, your mother, your loved one back to you, for that power belongs to God, but we can give you something eternal, and that is the Word of God. So in her memory, we would like to present the family with this heirloom Bible. Pray that you would accept our humble gift. We believe that this is her way of saying to you today that may God's peace be with you until we meet again. May God bless you is our prayer. We're preparing at this time for the recessional. Our clergy are already in position for the recessional, and we will ask that if you're going to the cemetery, that at the recessional, please go directly to your vehicles, turn your headlights and flashers on so that you may be identified with the funeral procession. We do have police escorts that are awaiting us on the outside, so if you're going to the cemetery, please go directly to your vehicle, directly to your vehicle. Turn your headlights and flashes on as the procession will be leaving momentarily. Family will receive you for a time of repast back here at Davie Community Worship Center. Thank you so much. And we're standing at this time. Just prior to us leaving, can I get some ladies or gentlemen to serve as flower bearers, please? If I can get some ladies and gentlemen to come and assist us with getting the flowers outside as well. Those gentlemen whose names are on the program as a pallbearer, would you kindly make your way, show wherever you are. If you are a pallbearer, let me see where you are as we process out pallbearers. Please meet us in the lobby out front immediately so that you can help us get down the stairs. Thank you.